You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Liz Miele joins us. She's originally from New Jersey. Where in New Jersey?
Right outside of Princeton.
I'm from Englewood. Liz Miele started doing stand-up at the age of 16 in New York City. By the time she was 18, The New Yorker magazine was profiling her. At 22, Liz Miele appeared on Comedy Central's Live at Gotham. You might have seen her on Access TV's Gotham Comedy Live or Hulu's Coming to the Stage. Welcome, Liz Miele.
Thank you.
You started doing comedy at 16.
I did. Which always is unimpressive because I kind of still look like I'm 16.
You do. But that's because you're a marathon runner. When was the last time you ran a marathon?
I think it was 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago. I hurt my back, so I took off. I took off from running for the longest I've ever taken off is 8 months. And then before that, I just was doing like half marathons because my tour schedule was getting so crazy that to run a marathon and not train is beyond torture. So half marathons in comparison were a lot easier.
So you started doing comedy at the age of 16. I want to get to that in 1 second, but we also have to talk about Declawed. This is this pilot that you're
working on.
You shot it already.
No, I wrote it and then now I'm actually cutting it down and I want to turn it into a short film.
Okay. You also co-produced and co-starred in 40 episodes of the web series called Apartment C3.
Yeah, Carmen Lynch, have you had her on the show? She was my roommate for 4 years, so I shot it with her and my still roommate, Chris, who's a fashion photographer.
Your debut comedy album, Emotionally Exhausting, is on iTunes and Amazon. Mind Over Miele.
That came out in March.
So you've put out two comedy albums.
Mm-hmm.
Lot to talk about. Let's start at the beginning. Age of 16, you decide to do stand-up comedy.
Yeah.
Do you mind if I say I don't approve?
I agree. I mean, there's pros and cons to it. And looking back, there's so many things I would have done differently. I do wish I started at 15.
That's the point I'm making. Why did you wait so long? What kind of parents did you have that they would not allow you to do comedy at 10?
I discovered it when I was like 13. And I don't know how you discovered stand-up, but like Nobody would ever tell me that I was funny. Like, that wasn't how people interpreted me at all. But in my family, I would make people laugh. But most people, I was really shy and I was really reserved. And then when I wasn't shy, I was annoying. Mm-hmm. So most people said I was annoying. And then I remember doing an interview once and they were just like, so people think you're funny now? I'm like, no, most people still consider me annoying. But I wanted to be like a funny actress. And so I thought that was what I wanted to do. But you know when something's not completely connected? Like when you're dating somebody and you're like, I like them, they're great, but for some reason it's not. That's how I felt with acting. I was just like, I mean, I want the attention that Sandra Bullock is getting. And I like that she's being funny, but that's not exactly what I want to do. And then when I first saw stand-up when I was 13 years old, I was like, yes, I don't have to be around others. Everybody has to pay attention to me. I can say what I want to say. And I became obsessed and I started writing when I was 14 years old.
Wow.
And it was like, keep in mind, like I was doing drugs, like I was doing all the stuff, like especially
that you're supposed to do.
That you're
comedian.
Supposed to do, yeah. Like I was like trying to make out with people, but it wasn't working out. And I was doing drugs, and I was drinking, and I was hanging out with all these like punks and stuff. And I was clearly numbing myself. I think I even knew that when
How
I was
old?
14. So I knew I was numbing myself because like a part of me was like. I mean, looking back, I really know because as soon as I started doing stand-up, I stopped doing all of it. Like, it's actually really funny to look back on now, but I would go to these house parties when I was like 14, 15 years old, and we would get drunk and we'd do drugs or whatever. But then when I started doing stand-up, or really when I started writing, I didn't, you know, this is before like laptops and stuff. We had like a house computer like this computer that was in the living room that everybody used in my house, and most people's houses were like that. And so I would go to these parties and I would see a computer and all my friends are like making out and doing drugs, and I would be at the family computer typing up my jokes. Mm-hmm. I'm not even exaggerating. I did it probably from 14 to 16 years old. And then when I finished my jokes, sometimes I would do drugs or whatever. And then when I started doing stand-up, I started going to the city every weekend, and I would still go to these house parties, but everybody was already far drunker and I was super sober. And then it's almost how you feel as a stand-up, where everybody in the audience is drunk and you're like, why do people do this? Everybody looks stupid. So I would go to these parties. I would hang out for an hour. Everybody was drunk. I was on this kind of comedy high, and I would drive home and I would go home. Like, I don't think my parents, because I was a very responsible, irresponsible person, I don't think they knew I was doing all these drugs and drinking. And then when I started doing stand-up, I don't think they understood that I was like, I pushed myself out of this numbing phase. Like, I found this new, this new high, really.
Explain to me further on this, because I always think kids should not be actors. They should go to school. They should be spared this business. I think the business is so dangerous, but it sounds like you grew up in Princeton.
Yeah.
Sounds like Princeton was more dangerous than show business.
Well, I always say this, like whenever people are like, why did you get into comedy? I always said I was really sad.
Mm-hmm.
And people were like, well, that's not a good story. And I'm like, actually, it is. Like, I hated my childhood so much, and I was so deeply depressed and unhappy that just watching stand-up was a relief. Just watching it made me happy.
Right.
And then writing made me happier. And then performing made me even happier. And all of a sudden, I had this passion and this goal and this thing to kind of push me forward and get me out of bed and something to look forward to and kind of give me kind of inspiration. And it was that really... It was everything sucking so much when I was younger that when I started to do stand up and you do open mics, which are awful, and I recommend them to nobody, I'm like, well, everything sucks. So why does, at least I want to be here and it sucks. Like, school sucks and home sucks and extracurricular activities suck, but I don't want to be there. At least open mics and like shitty rooms, like there was a potential to growth. And I was so obsessed with stand-up when I was younger, and this is before podcasts and stuff. I read everybody's memoir and biography. I listened to any, my dad would like bring me in the room if there was like NPR, like if like Terry Gross was interviewing a comedian, he'd always be like, because they always rerun, they'll be like, oh, you know, Steve Martin's gonna be back on, da da da. And then when I was 18, my dad actually bought me this like comedians compilation of every comedian they've interviewed on, again, all before podcasts. So this was like wisdom that you couldn't get anywhere else. And I ate all that stuff up. And I knew before I even started that it took 10 years for you to find your voice.
Wow.
And that this was a long path. And so I didn't get into it at 16 being like, I'm going to be a star at 18. I got it at 16 being like, maybe when I'm 26, I might be funny.
Mm-hmm.
And so I actually got into stand-up, even though I think you're right that it is too young, because what the hell do I have to talk about? And what is my view on anything?
No, actually, it sounds like it's just right.
It was. In a lot of ways, it was.
That's my prejudice. I have a thing about... I'm fascinated.
I have a thing about
child actors.
If they want to do it themselves and they're willing to put the effort into it, I also think, make them take the bus to it. If you make them take the bus to go to soccer practice, you know what I mean? Like, if you're going to treat it the same way you might treat soccer practice, by all means. If they're going to put in the effort and if they're going to do all the work and they see that this is a lot. But if you're going to drop your life and, like, keep in mind, like, I've heard stories, like, the reason we have Taylor Swift is because her parents, like, dropped their life, moved to Tennessee so that she can, because they believed she had talent. And that's amazing. Like, by all means, if your family's behind you like that. But, like, if you're dragging a kid to do, you know, Campbell's commercials, I think you're the devil. Like, I think if it's their passion, by all means, put them in it. But I also think they should be listening to podcasts now, and they should be reading books, and they should know how horrible this business is. Because if I wasn't in therapy, I would be dead by now. Like, this is such a toxic environment. And it's only because I grew up in a toxic environment that I'm able to sustain myself in a toxic environment. And that goes with the whole why are comedians sad and depressed and whatever. Well, you kind of have to be to tread water in this environment.
I think if you have musical ability and you're a prodigy, sometimes it can't be stopped. I think there's some kids who are born with musical ability, and it's a sin not to encourage it at the age of 5. I don't think there's such a thing as a comedic prodigy at the age of 5, 6, 7. And it sounds like you understood that at 14, 16, that this is a 10-year process.
I always knew it was work, and I didn't have the self-esteem.
I mean, do you think there's somebody like a Robin Williams at the age of 10 who's just running around where people say this guy's a genius, he has to do comedy?
But he worked hard even at 10. So like when you hear stories of like Jim Carrey, he was in his room making faces and trying to do all these voices and stuff. Yeah. A lot of my friends are magicians, uh-huh. which is a weird thing to brag about. But I
like magic.
They're brilliant too, yeah. and they're making way more money than I am. But what I loved about my friends, I made friends with them when I was 18 years old. And what I loved about it is their dorkiness is more behind doors because they're practicing over and over the sleight of hand stuff. And then they present it rather than we have to practice in front of people. But what I liked about it is the same relentless practice. And for somebody to do like a slight thing, it took hours and hours mm-hmm. of being by themselves, working with their hands and trying to figure it out. And that's how I feel about just trying to be funny. Like it really was years and years and years right. of me just bombing and not being good and not thinking anything was going
to
come
What happened? You got profiled in the New Yorker magazine at 18. So 2 years in, you get profiled in the New York. What was that about? Like,
it was about being a barker. So things have really changed in New York now.
What's a barker?
So a barker is somebody that hands out flyers for stage time. So now most of the barkers you see are getting paid and they're not comedians. Some might be comedians. It might be how they get into it. But it used to be a lot of clubs, not all of them, but a lot of clubs, especially kind of the lower clubs. If you wanted stage time, it was a way for you to get on stage. So I would say it might not be the complete order, but I would say it's like open mics and bringer shows, handout flyers are kind of all on that kind of level.
And in Times Square, there are paid professional barkers who tell yeah. you that, you know, Steve Martin is going to be at the club.
Yeah,
they say anything to get
But I worked at Ha Comedy Club, which I think barely still exists, but it still exists. It's one of the shittiest clubs in the city. But, you know, I was 16, 17 years old, and I was able to hand out flyers for an hour and get on stage. And they were doing three shows a night every single night. Like,
and how big were the audiences?
I mean, they could be anywhere from 10 people to 75 people. You know what I mean?
Mostly tourists,
you know, people that didn't really plan their night because now they're in this weird place. You know, at the time it was on 42nd. It was on a Restaurant Row, 42nd mm-hmm. and like 9th Ave.
You're coming in from Princeton?
Yeah, I would come in when I was
how?
Six, New Jersey Transit. I would take it every weekend. It was funny. When I was 16, I was a junior in high school and I would take it every weekend. And then when I was a senior and I got into college and my grades were good, I convinced my dad to let me go Thursday through Sunday.
So you went to college?
I did. I went to the new school.
I would think you get the comedy bug at 16. That's great.
I wish I didn't. I'll be honest. I
didn't go to college.
I wish I didn't. I think college is a waste of time for most people unless you're going to become like a doctor or a lawyer or something that you need it. If I could do it all over
again. What'd you major in?
Creative writing, which I'm better at it. I made some good friends. I read some good books. I'm dyslexic, so school is always really hard for me. So I would always have to pick two classes to actually do the work in and two classes right. to bullshit. And I did that through high school. I did that through college. I liked college. I couldn't keep up. So right. I kept all my college books and it took me 6 years to read all of them.
Right.
Like that's how slow of a reader I am.
What kind of dyslexia do you have?
It's not the worst because my little brother, I'm one of five kids and my brother has it the worst. We all have it though. And my dad gave it to us.
He's a veterinarian.
Yeah. Both my parents are veterinarians.
I have to go operate on this god.
Yeah, exactly. But it is kind of crazy because my dad didn't know he had dyslexia until he had a bunch of kids that were dyslexic. He just knew everything was harder for him and right. he would have his my great aunt, his aunt would type up all his papers and stuff for him because he couldn't keep up. But I don't know how he went through vet school. I still don't know how he did that. And he got rejected all the time because he couldn't keep his grades up.
I was just reading an interview with Jay Leno, who has dyslexia.
Yeah.
And he's been open about it. And
yeah.
what a great service that is to yeah. people, because if people don't open up about dyslexia, then more and more people keep it quiet.
Yeah.
And then they create shame.
And you lose a lot of people that would go after things that don't. Like, I think...
First of all, comedy... Some of the greatest comedians are dyslexic.
Eddie Izzard, I just went to an interview. I was at an interview at Sirius that he was at, and he's dyslexic, and that like blew my mind.
Yeah, I had a boss who was dyslexic. He didn't he was older and he didn't like anybody to know. So I'm not going to blow his cover. But I knew he was dyslexic and he thought differently.
Yeah,
and he
you
was
do.
A genius. He was a comedy genius because he saw things differently. Your father became a veterinarian. So as Jay Leno said in this article in the New York Times yesterday, David Itzkoff interviewed him. He said, I had dyslexia. My mother said I had to work twice as hard.
And you do. You, I mean, you not only work twice as hard, but you have to, you build up coping skills. So they say like 80% of entrepreneurs are, have some kind of learning disability or dyslexic. I actually wonder, because I talked at a dyslexic school in DC. A friend of mine was a teacher, and I talked to like all these eight-year-olds about my experience being dyslexic. And it's a dyslexic, you know, learning disability school. I actually wonder if you make dyslexics entrepreneurs because you put them in this very stagnant way of learning. You have to learn this way, and our brains don't learn this way.
Right.
So you have to find out a way around to learn that way, or at least get to the end result that these people want. And I wonder if you put dyslexics in a school where you do figure out how they learn stuff, if it's going to hinder their ability to be entrepreneurs. Not to say that they don't think creatively, which we do kind of naturally,
right,
but because they don't have the same challenges. Because, and I don't know if this is true, this is just a theory in my mind, but like a lot of my problem-solving skills came from the fact that this paper, I have to write a 10-page paper. It's due, you know, in a week. I have to read 500 pages. There's no way in hell I'm going to read 500. How do I solve this problem? So I do that with everything. And like the biggest skill dyslexics have is divergent thinking. So for one problem, we can come up with 50 different solutions.
All right, slow down. This is really important to me for several reasons. One is a lot of my, I'm going to make a joke. I'm going to say a lot of my listeners can't read. But the ones who aren't from Alabama can't read because they're either blind and they read in Braille.
Mm-hmm.
But I've spoken to a lot of my listeners, and a lot of them have dyslexia where they don't, it's so bad they can't read a newspaper or read their Kindle. And I often catch myself using the term illiterate because that's almost a pejorative. If you're dyslexic and you can't, there are people who just can't read because of a physical, not because they're intellectually malnourished, it's because they can't.
Yeah. So I mean I don't have it the worst. I would say I'm like smack dab in the middle. I have difficulty reading. I'm a slow reader. I misread a lot. I have trouble pronouncing. I can't spell to save my life. I have a hard time remembering stuff. My math is awful. Like, I read this book called The Dyslexic Advantage when I was 25, and it changed my life. I actually spoke at their conference.
The Dyslexic Advantage.
Mm-hmm. It's one of the best books I ever read, because all the books on dyslexia are like, what's wrong with your brain? But this was the first book that I ever read that was like, these are all the benefits.
Right.
And it helped me because it made me see that there's things that I didn't know that I could naturally do them. Like, I would just do them. And I think it's the reason I'm a good comic. I think it's a reason I'm a good friend and problem solver. But it all came from the fact that for whatever reason, my brain works differently.
Okay. Is there a type of dyslexia where you hear things differently?
I don't know. I mean, I definitely have my audit, like most dyslexics like listening to stuff, but I'm a visual learner.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually, like, if you give me directions, it's, you might as well talk to a wall.
Right.
But if you write directions or make me a map, I'm amazing. And I can pull it that
way. Tell me the levels of dyslexia.
I mean, keep in mind, there's also different forms of learning disabilities. So not all of them, because there's like dysgraphia, there's dyslexia, there's like.
See, I hate to sound like a narcissist, but I am. I know I had some kind of learning disability growing up, especially when it came to math.
Yeah, and math is something that we struggle with as well.
I just couldn't get geometry, and
you could just be dumb. So
I could be dumb, not could. And the gift of not being good at math was I just got really, although my listeners would disagree, got really good at my verbal and literary skills.
Yeah. You compensate.
You compensate,
I always say school didn't teach me how to learn. It taught me how to bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And what do I do for a living? I kind of bullshit.
Everything is bullshit.
Yeah. And it's how do you, you know, how do you convince somebody you've read a book you've never read? I'm almost a genius in that. If that was a TED Talk, please sign me up.
Okay. I apologize for not knowing this. Blind people can read in Braille.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a level of dyslexia where you have to resort to Braille, where you can see, but the only way you can read is through Braille?
I don't know.
Are there people who are, I apologize for asking this question. Are there people who can't read because of the dyslexia?
Oh, absolutely. There's severe dyslexia.
What is that? They're seeing the letters are just jumbled?
They're jumbled. I mean, the cool thing now, just like, you know, if you were gluten-free 15 years ago, you didn't eat food. If you're gluten-free now, the world is your oyster. You have so many options. Now with dyslexia, like, they make special font that's supposed to help you see it better.
It's called dyslexia font.
Yeah, it's so cool.
Yeah. Kindle has that.
Yeah, and then, you know, now they have these, you can speak into your phone and it types it for you. It's not perfect, but again, that's something that if I had that, my father had it, anybody had that, would have completely saved them time and energy and frustration. It's. I know for me.
Okay, I help me out. So, the letters and numbers are jumbled on a page.
For some people, they're not. I don't know if they're jumbled.
But if you see three human beings walking down the street, are they jumbled?
But there's a difference between something that's learned, like words, and a physical being. You know what I mean? So, like, I don't see things upside down. Like my.
If you look at a painting, what do you see?
I hopefully see the same painting you're seeing. But then the other thing is perspective. So you have to keep in mind that, you know, you might see something and it's this beautiful picture of a river. And either I might focus on a flower or I might focus on the fact that, you know, there's a splotch on it. Like, it becomes about perspective. So because I have to focus on the words differently than you, it's changed my perspective. So one of the advantages they said in this book is you read a book, you take in the information, you move on. But I sometimes have to read a sentence three or four times because I don't understand it, or a paragraph a couple of times, because I always say, like, it took me a long time to say this, but I'm not dumb, I'm slow. Because I'll get there, it just takes me a lot longer. But because I'm slow, I'm more meticulous. Mm-hmm. And I have to really, like dig deep into the information. And I often retain information more than most people. I understand it on a deeper level. I've thought about it analytically because I have to. Because I couldn't get past that paragraph until I did. Because things don't just come into my brain easily. So there's a lot of my stand-up incorporates things that I've read and experiences that I've had in a way that most people wouldn't, because my brain just functions differently. And then I don't know how true this is, but, you know, you have dyslexic, where they basically say, so they say there's a part in your brain that is just, it's good at doing math and reading. Like, that's what that part of the brain's made for. But dyslexics use this shitty part of their brain that is not made for that, so it does a shitty job. Mm-hmm. And so it's slower, it makes you more tired. Like, I fall asleep reading within 2 pages every time.
Right. I think most people do.
Yeah. But it's like, it just exhausts that part of the brain because it's not meant to do that. It's like, you know, everybody else has an automatic lawnmower and you're over there with clippers. Mm-hmm. You look stupid all the time. Right. And that's how your brain works. And so for me, finding different tools, different ways to function have made me a stronger reader in some senses, because I found tricks. Like, when I read, like, it'll be like, you know, Mrs. Roebuck, like, because that might take me a little bit, she's now Mrs. R, to the point where I might read the same book as you and they'll be like, oh my God, I can't believe Mrs. Roebuck did that. And it'll take me a second because I've never pronounced Mrs. Roebuck. She's always Mrs. R. That's just how I've digested it. It's a trick I've made up so that I don't get stuck on it and I can move forward. But with that part of my brain, all you've really done is found skills that kind of push you differently. I love diagnosing people from, like, reading their Facebook statuses or their tweets, if they're dyslexic or not, because there's certain mistakes people make. And there's also really cool things people say that is just very typically dyslexic. And so when I heard Eddie Izzard was dyslexic, it totally made sense to me, because he's a big picture thinker. And that's what dyslexics do, which is, you know, you're here and I'm going to bring you over here. And most people can't see how you do that. But a dyslexic doesn't know how to not take you from one place to the other.
You take them to your comfort zone?
No, I wouldn't say comfort zone. You can basically talk about paperclips and somehow convince people that that's why Trump got elected. Like, really crazy, weird stuff by taking something small and making it bigger picture. And it's a weird natural
Well, they said
skill.
George W. Bush might have been dyslexic.
I can see that.
And he always said, I'm a big picture guy.
Yeah. And you can, I mean, there's certain mistakes are pretty obviously, like, I skip words, like certain words just, they're just not there.
But isn't that how they teach you speed reading?
Which is interesting because my dad tried to learn and I was like, I won't retain anything if that's.
Your dad is a very successful veterinarian.
Yeah.
He's dyslexic and he tried speed reading.
Yeah.
Because.
He wanted to read more. My dad's an avid reader. I'm an avid reader. I like taking in information via reading because, like I said, I absorb it more. It takes me a lot longer, but because I'm so visual and because it is a challenge to it, there's something about reading that actually, even though it's really hard for me, it keeps me focused and I take in more information. Rather than if I watch a documentary, I'll gain some stuff, but I don't have to focus the same way I have to focus when I read. So,
when did you become a avid reader?
My dad made me read every single night to watch TV. If we wanted to watch an hour of television, we had to read every night for like 2
Interesting.
Hours. Interesting. Yeah, and I lied.
And that's not, let me just take a side road here for a second. Was that emotionally abusive?
There was definitely a lot of emotional abuse in my family.
No, I'm talking about like saying TV is evil, unplugging the TV, maybe telling your kids that you have to read, the TV is a vast wasteland. Would that be unfair for a parent to say that, or perhaps father knew best?
He's honestly, if I had kids, I would institute that rule. Yeah. He was a little over, like my dad was super controlling. Is this something you do?
I'm sorry, I'm just getting angry. Hang on, let me just calm down.
Yeah, what are you angry about?
I'm not saying the word.
As a TV writer, is this why you're angry?
No. Nope, I'm not going to bring up my personal life. No, I just, there was one couple times where I'd come home from work. The kids would be watching TV and they wouldn't say hello to me. And I'd unplug the TV and take it into the garage.
Yeah.
And that was considered.
Abuse?
Well, not nice.
Well, I mean.
But I
don't disagree.
Like, I want to get back to reading.
But this is. So
your father, did he know that reading was difficult for you?
He didn't let us use it as an excuse. And in a lot of ways, I'm grateful, but in a lot of ways, it, like I said, taught me how to bullshit. It didn't teach me how to learn.
Because reading to me is the most important thing next to sex.
I agree.
And it's not for everybody, but I just measure my mental health based on my ability to read. Because for years, I couldn't read. Even in college, I couldn't read.
Yeah.
I couldn't do the work. I felt stupid. I didn't feel smart. I could never just relax and lose myself in a book because I was constantly feeling stupid.
Yeah, I agree.
Why don't I know this? Why don't I know this? And then I discovered that most people aren't willing to admit that they read something and didn't understand it.
Oh, yeah.
And then I got really angry. I got really mad at the world where I thought, so I'm not stupid. I'm hypercritical of myself and everybody else is BSing me.
Yeah.
One of the things I do on this show all the time is ask people about their reading schedules, what they read, do they understand it, do they go back? A lot of people are ashamed of the way they read and aren't willing to admit that they don't know something.
I read a book about...
And it makes me angry because it's in many ways worse than physical bullying. I hate intellectual bullies.
I agree. Absolutely. There's actually a guy, I was telling my boyfriend, this guy made me feel bad. He was like, I was at like kind of like a shitty show and we were just talking about traveling and stuff like that. And then I didn't realize they called Trumpers, what do they call them?
There's Cucks?
Make America Great Again.
MAGAs.
I didn't know that was a
term. I just learned it.
Yeah, I didn't know it was a term. So he said MAGAs, and I go, oh, what's a MAGA? Because I ask questions all the time. Yeah. I don't know anything. And he goes, you don't know what MAGAs are? And I was like, no. And then he said, make America. I was like, okay. So then a little while later, he goes, are you a professional comic? That's what he asked me. Are you a pro comic? Which I thought was a weird way to ask it. I usually just ask people if they do it full time. And I was like, yeah, I do it full time. And then we talked about something. I said a word. I mispronounced it. And I was like, that doesn't sound right. And then I corrected myself. And he responded by going, you're a pro comic? And it hurt my feelings so bad because I'm still constantly getting my feelings hurt by misspelling stuff or saying things wrong because it's never going to go away. I'm 32 years old and I still don't know how to spell and I still don't know how to pronounce a lot of stuff and I still struggle to understand things. And a part of me was like, well, why am I not looked at in despite of this, I'm a professional comic, rather than how did you get here? You don't even know how to pronounce this word. But it really, I mean, I ranted to my boyfriend. It hurt my feelings that this kid made this. And he probably didn't think anything of it. Probably didn't even think, he might have even thought he was making a joke. But to me, it hurt so much. But I read this book. What I like about Malcolm Gladwell, and I know not everybody loves him, but what he does is he makes these studies more digestible. So he wrote David and Goliath and talks a lot about dyslexics. But right after that, he quoted somebody else's book about learning disability. So I bought that book and I started reading it. And it was a guy that had learning disability. It wasn't dyslexia. And he wrote about all the other learning disabilities. And there are three chapters in there that I have no idea what he was talking about. So here's a dude with learning disabilities that studied them. And I still don't understand what he said. And it was like, I remember calling my dad and being like, I read one of the chapters twice and I still don't know what he said. And I was like, how'd this guy make me feel dumb?
I was reading the paper today and I just couldn't understand. Like, I agreed with everything that I was reading and I just started getting lost. I couldn't make the connections. I think that's exhaustion and will. You have to have the will to want to learn. I get really upset with people who try to make you feel stupid.
Yeah.
I really do. And you know, I worked for Dennis Miller for 10 years, who was a professional bully. At the height of his fame and gift, he was a parody of a professional bully.
Mm-hmm.
The thing I took away from working for him for so long is that you can intimidate people into laughing and agreeing with you by using obscure references or language and words. And it's all a confidence game.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's all a confidence game. If you're confident in your tone of voice, people will think, I can trust this guy to rip open my heart and do the transplant.
But don't you think that's like, I remember seeing Good Will Hunting, and I think that's the reason I liked it, is you have these people that have gone to Harvard and that think because they have this degree and because they got into this school that they're better than you, that they're smarter than you. And then you have a dude that's like, I don't know. I read a couple of books and I can deduce my thoughts on my own. So one of the reasons I am kind of anti-college in a lot of ways is school teaches you how to think like other people rather than you read a bunch of books, but then you are by yourself. You have to deduce, well, do I agree with that? Do I think life works this way? Do I want life to work this way? And you have to come up with your ideas on your own. So when I was 16 years old, I was told to speak when spoken to, that my opinion isn't important, whether it was flat out said that way or is interpreted that way. But you don't talk when anybody else is talking and your opinions don't matter. This is what we're eating. This is what we're doing. This is how you're going to help us out. And every weekend, like we were joking about it. Me and my sister were home. We were joking about you wake up Saturday morning and there's a to-do list and it's expected to get done by Sunday night. And my dad used to pick us up from sleepovers at 6 a.m. to start our day. So that's how I grew up. And so when I started doing stand-up, it wasn't because I thought I had an opinion. It was because I didn't know if I was capable of having one. And it was the first time that I was like, I don't know how I feel about things because I was told not to have feelings.
Right.
Literally told to suppress my feelings. So I did. So I didn't know how I felt about stuff. I didn't know what stuff
Well, your parents, both of whom are veterinarians.
Yeah.
I know that doctors have kids who complain that they were emotionally distant.
Yeah.
Like you think you have problems.
Yeah.
What's it like growing up with two parents who are veterinarians?
Well, I think people become vets because they have trouble connecting to humans. And I would say my parents, my dad, so I didn't really know how to dress. Like I've just started to have a style, in quotations, in the last 5 years. And it's because I looked at other women. So I'm pretty sure I'm already a female comedian. I'm sure everybody thought I was a lesbian, but I would look at other women that had bodies like me and I'd be like, oh, I think I'd look good in that. And then I would go to H&M and I would try to recreate that and be like, oh, okay, her butt kind of looks like mine. She's stocky like me. I think I could do that. And that's how I built up how to have a style. My dad did that with a personality in a lot of ways. My dad, I think, had one of the worst childhoods I've ever heard of. And he had no money and he's dyslexic and he had a dream and, you know, he wanted to connect to people, and I don't think he knew how. So my dad is a self-help guru. I have a joke about it. My dad has read every Tony Robbins book.
Is amazing. Tony Robbins.
I think there's pros and cons. I'll never say that he's pure evil, but I'll never say that
Why would he be evil?
I think it's a lot of talk with a lot of inaction. And I want to write a movie about it, but I've been to 4 Tony Robbins seminars with
him. Oh, really? Because I watch him all the time. I think he's...
I think comedians are actually addicted to self-help in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
So my dad is addicted to self-help. I would still say I'm addicted to self-help in a lot of ways. I've kind of moved forward and now I read a lot more psychology. It's more like understanding and trying to see the problems, and therapy has kind of pushed me in a different direction. But I've read just about every self-help book my dad has read and 7 more.
What's the best self-help book you read that actually helped?
The Dyslexic Advantage.
By the way, my idea of self-help is internet porn. Is that funny?
I mean, I could see you are helping yourself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you're not harming others. I think it works. But actually, this book called, I wouldn't even say it's a self-help book, a First-Rate Madness. It's about, basically the thesis, I would say, is in a time of stability, you want a leader that is mentally stable. In a time of crisis, you want a leader that's mentally ill. And he goes through all the leaders we've had in the past that were mentally ill and why they were great. So Abraham Lincoln, Gandhi, Martin Luther King. He talks about Hitler, and he talks about why Hitler was a great leader in the sense that what he was capable of doing,
was he emotionally stable or not?
I'm joking. But like, he talks about the drugs that he took and all this kind of crazy stuff. And so it talks about how, you know, there's the positivities of mental illness. But the whole book is about, just like the Dyslexic Advantage talks about the advantages of dyslexia, this is a whole book that talks about the advantages of mental illness as somebody that deals with it themselves and has family members that deal with it. So I wouldn't say it's a self-help book as much as it's a book that's talking about the positivities of stuff.
Well, there's good mental illness and bad mental illness.
And there's also dealing with it and not dealing with it. You know what I mean? Like, my brother isn't too dissimilar from the people you see on the subway yelling at people, but my brother's on medication. My brother's been hospitalized many times. My brother has a family that takes care of him. So
what does he have?
He's bipolar 1. So he's been hospitalized 4 times. He's been picked up by the cops. I mean, I have a joke about him setting fire to all my father's self-help books, which did happen.
Really?
And then my mom, to quote my mother, she said it was the sanest thing anybody in this family's ever done. My mom is one of the funniest people I've ever met.
Do veterinarians talk about the psychological conditions of cats and dogs?
I think they're so... I mean, it feels like comics even... Like, I've been doing it 15 years. A lot of my friends have been doing it as long, if not longer. You still do talk about that stuff, but eventually...
I'm talking about veterinarians.
But I'm saying even in my own community, you stop kind of talking about that stuff after a while. So, like...
What, because it's banal?
You just kind of know. Like, it's like... You don't need to. It's like somebody says something crazy and you look at your friend and you just make a look and
I'm talking about cats and dogs. You can tell if a cat or a dog is mentally ill.
I think you can kind of tell. I don't think they say animals are trained by humans so that if they were left in the wild, they wouldn't have anxiety, that they that they wouldn't have bad habits. They would have survival habits and that's it. But because they live so closely with humans, our dispositions get pushed onto
them. We make them neurotic.
Exactly. So my cat has habits that I've created. If I take out my luggage or her carrier, she hides in the closet. I actually have to take everything out 3 days before because she knows she's going to go to my parents and she's going to sleep in a cage. So she has been trained. My cat also, you know, cries if I don't pay attention to her, which is almost who I was growing up. So I've conditioned her in a really shitty way, not even on purpose, just accidentally. So I think the same thing happens with kids, cats, and so forth.
Do you think, I was at the gym last night and America's Got Talent was on, and there was a woman doing this dance routine with a dog, and everybody just stopped Some people started to cry. The dog was so cute. The dog, and then Simon Cowell just yelled at the judges to, you got to pick this woman with her dog. You have to say yes. And they kept shooting the dog. The camera kept shooting the dog. And like everybody in the gym just stopped and melted at the dog. Dogs are ruining our lives. You will never get the kind of love from a human that you can get from a dog.
Yeah, but, and this might be from child abuse. Who wants unearned love? You know what I mean? Like, I think the reason I have a cat is I earned that cat's love. And I'm not exaggerating. My cat was an asshole for 3 years, and she loves the fuck out of me now. But it was like, I mean, I cuddle abused this cat, and I would like shower her with gifts. Like I did.
All right, that's you. I think dogs are like porn.
I can see that. I mean,
you don't have to work for it. They just, you know, and I think it's making us weak.
But sugar would be the same way? Alcohol would be the same way?
I don't think alcohol is good. I think dogs are ruining relationships because we love them so much, and no human can be as good as a dog.
Well, of course, because you have feelings. So, you know, if I walk through the door, like one of my favorite things, like I've only been with my boyfriend for 9 months. And my favorite thing is in the morning he smiles. Or like sometimes I get up earlier than him and I'll like be in the living room and I'll get work done. And he opens the door and he has this big smile on his face. And sometimes I get really sad because I think someday he's not going to wake up and smile because I did something wrong. Or mm-hmm. he had a bad day and he's just kind of used to me always being there. And it's going to be this moment where I don't just automatically get that smile. And it really breaks my heart.
But you're making that happen then.
Maybe. I mean, my goal is to hopefully not be.
You have to just assume that he's always going to smile at you, and then he will.
And I hope so. I really do, because it's my favorite thing. Like, not exaggerating. But with a dog, because there's no real emotions involved, you open up the door, and they're happy to see you. And you bring out the leash.
You don't think it's real emotions?
I think it's survival. I think it's a different type of survival. Just like,
don't you think we train dogs and we train them and kind of create them by breeding them a certain way? Don't you think we've created dogs who understand what love is? I think when they were in the wild, it was all about pack and hierarchy. I think now it's love.
But how is this not pack and hierarchy? This person, think about people that social climb. You go to a party and they meet you and they go and you go, oh, hey. And you can be like, oh, what have you done? And you'll be like, oh, I do open mics. And all of a sudden they just walk away. You're like, oh, God. Right. You know what I mean? And then they go find somebody that's been on television because they know that person can help them get further or whatever. We all see it.
That's why whenever I go to a party, the first thing I do is sniff their ass.
Exactly. But like, it's kind of the same thing. This person feeds me. This person takes me out so I can relieve myself. This person cuddles with me. This person gives me treats. Why would you not be nice to me?
But that's what love is.
Is it? Because what about the days that somebody can't provide for you? What about the boyfriend that has no money or the girlfriend that has sad days? Like, the truth is that I'm not always going to be the best version of myself and people still love me.
Yeah.
Is that why you still love them when they pee on the carpet?
Yeah, I mean, I think a dog will love you even when you forget to feed the dog or when you forget to take him out or if you ignore the dog. I think in a relationship.
But if somebody ignored you too long, you get rid of them.
I don't know. What do I know?
I think we ruined this analogy.
I don't know. I don't know anything anymore. I thought I knew. I thought I had all the answers. I do think dogs love us. I used to think they didn't.
I do. I mean, I think there is.
I think cats hate us.
I agree with that as well. And I have so much love for cats. I mean, I think if I was raised in a healthier environment, I wouldn't be chasing cats' love.
I said to one of my daughters a year ago, she says, how you doing? I said, you know, the other night, I was up till 4 a.m. watching cat videos on YouTube. And I said, I think I'm losing it. And she said, no, you finally figured out what the internet was for.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I go, what? She goes, that's all the internet is for, is watching cat videos. Is that true?
It is 100% true. I feel healthier now that I'm not alone, because that's,
but
I mean,
why are cat video? What is it?
Because they're, so somebody,
not dog videos.
So this is what somebody told
me. It's not dog videos.
But this is what somebody explained to me that works for my mom, and it makes perfect sense. Cat videos are there to show off their cat, because most cats are indoors and you can't show them off. Rather than dog video, dogs, you walk them, people, you know, and it's a more social being. So you can show off your dog and your dog can do tricks and blah, blah, blah. Your dog has an outdoor life. Rather than your mostly probably indoor cat, you can't show it off. And there's all these cute things they're doing next to the bed or by their water bowl or whatever, whatever. So it's a way for cat people to show off their animal. And then in general, they're just so cute. Like, they're the cutest.
My favorite cat video of the year is the window washer.
What's the window washer?
There's a cat who's stuck on like the 54th floor of a building, and the window washer is washing the window, and he notices that when he moves the sponge to the left, the cat's head moves to the right. He moves it to the right, the cat's head moves to the left. And then he just starts doing it back and forth, and the head keeps... And I thought, I get the chills thinking about this, because here's a human being outside a building on the 45th floor.
Yeah.
He could...
die.
And he's playing with a cat.
Yeah.
And I think, when I watch it, because I keep watching, I go, man, human beings can be incredible.
Yeah.
That's an incredible statement about humans, that I'm on the outside of a 45-story building that was built by men. I'm being paid to wash these windows.
And I'm going to take a second to play with a cat.
I'm going to play with a cat.
You know what my favorite cat video is? There's this cat. It's like a wreck, so it has like very little hair. And the woman goes to pet it, and the cat takes the woman's hand and just pushes it down to say, like, no. And then just goes back to what it's doing. It makes me laugh every time. Just this very, like, no.
But shouldn't we be having these relationships with humans?
I do. I definitely have told people not to touch me.
I worry that cats and dogs are surrogate humans, and they're better than humans, and it's why we're so mean to one another. Because we don't need each other anymore. We've got cats and
dogs.
Wouldn't
you say that about your cell phone or Netflix? Or, I mean, you could say that about anything. I mean, we're all trying to find the perfect version, and in some ways, they're the easier version, because real relationships take work. But I think there's some people that enjoy
real relationships take work, and I think they're harder because cats and dogs,
they're endlessly cute. Cats will always be cute until like the last 6 months when their hair starts falling out and they're the worst. But like, you know what I mean? Like, I have bad days and good days. Like, cats have like three problems. You know what I mean? While we are...
Yeah, I, as somebody who is a borderline vegan, and somebody who, when he had a wife and kids, had at any given time four cats and at least three dogs in the house, I'm a big animal person. But I think we need to value humans over animals.
But I think what's happening, just like you said, there's so much, it's so much easier. Like, they even say it's so much easier to access porn that it is making people just not work for the relationship.
Right.
You have to learn. Like, I always think it's funny that men are like, you have to learn how to talk to women. And I'm like, well, stop treating them like they're not humans. Like, they have things that they're excited about and they're not excited about. And you have things that you're not excited about. If you start talking about women as just people, then you don't have to learn how to talk to them. You really just have to learn how to talk to people.
I hear, I've been told that all women are not the same. I'm joking. that's been one of the complaints that we have. Come on in. You can sit at the head of the table. Melissa Stokoski is here.
How are you?
Good to see you.
Thank you for having me.
Why don't you sit over here? Why don't you sit at the head of the table?
Okay, great.
I think we just do shows together. Well, I think that's it.
If I'm here, I know Liz Mealy's here.
Melissa Stokoski.
Talk about cats. Yep, that's pretty accurate.
Melissa's a comedian, a writer from Brooklyn, New York. She is a producer and host of the long-running stand-up show Bitches Brew, as well as the interactive Twitter show Like Me Comedy. She's a regular guest on Sirius XM's Radio Andy, and appears every Tuesday. Let me see if I can get this name right. Mm-hmm. John.
It's confusing.
John Fugel sang, is that his name?
Yeah, I hadn't heard of him.
Yeah. Tell Me Everything on Insight.
Right.
And you've been featured on True TV's Late Night Snack, and you're a freelance contributor for Elite Daily. What's Elite Daily?
It is really the only top-notch journalism for the millennial voice. It's a lot of articles like top 10 ways that I buy shoes in Manhattan. Stuff, you know, really hard-hitting, smart journalism. They really actually let me go wild. I'm kind of lucky they let me publish, because I was kind of writing satire of what they do, and they just kept publishing it.
That was so Elite. It was there's neat. An Elite magazine, too, right?
I believe so. I don't know if they're affiliated.
Very quickly, your accent, are you from Cleveland?
Close. Detroit. Metro Detroit. He was asking, we were out there, I was like, do you like cats? And it just came out really Midwestern. He was like, where are you from? And I was like, yeah, Detroit. Well, I was just in Chicago, so any bit that I lost, I gained back that week in Chicago. It just all came back. It all came back. It's also, the worst part is, I think Midwestern people laugh like as a honk, which it's like a complimenting, like, ha, you know, as a as a nice gift. And I think I dropped that, and it is really force came back. Yeah, if I'm around my Detroit friends who live in New York too, we really...
So very quickly, because I always assume if you're African-American, you know all other African-Americans.
Sure.
I'm going to assume... Since you're both women, you know each other.
We do. Yeah.
How do you know each other?
Well, did I met you, I feel like I met you before we did Fugel Sang show
we
together.
We did, but I don't remember where.
Yeah.
I think it was stand-up related.
Well, the hardest thing about meeting other female comics is it's gotten slightly better in the last couple of years, but for the most part, you're usually the token woman on a show. So for guys make such stronger friends in comedy because you can book a show and it'll be all your guy friends rather than if I want to see my female comic friends, I have to go visit them after my spot. Where are you going to be? Well, I'm the only female comic at New York. Well, I'm going to be at stand-up. Like,
it's very
true. So there, occasionally there'll be two women on a show, but more likely she was on a show. My friend was on the show. I went to go visit my friend and I'll be like, oh, she's funny. And then it's so hard to make female comic friends. Not because we don't want to. It's just because
the logistics.
Yeah, the logistics of
it. Is that changing, though? You just said it's changing.
Slightly. I definitely feel like I love... Like, New York Comedy Club, I think, books, like, a lot of female comics. Same with Stand Up New York. In general, more female comics are coming out. They're being appreciated more. They're having more time to develop. We're getting on TV more. And then in general, I think with more of us being on TV, people are like, well, people might want to see them. And so you get on stage more. So you're still going to be pitched as an all-female show, just like you see these all-black shows and these
Have you seen the Twitter? It's called One Woman on the Lineup. And it's anonymous. I don't know who's running it or anything, but they just retweet these lineups. In LA, it happens a lot too. One woman on the lineup. It's constantly.
No, you are the diversity. There's always one black guy and there's always one woman.
Well, I mean... But it is representative of our population.
Not in New York City,
I'm making
though.
A joke. 51% of America.
But people always say, well, there's less female comics. Yeah, if you go to Ohio.
Right.
But in New York City, and especially L.A., I think, I'm sure it's not 50-50, but there's a lot of us there. And they actually say there's a lot, in the beginning, it's about 50-50, just as many women, just as many men, but we drop off a lot faster. And some might, you know, there's always like, well, pregnancy, da-da-da, but I don't think, we're still pretty young. I think a lot of it is, well, if it's so much harder to get stage time and people aren't really paying attention to us, you know, you weed out maybe the not strong, but you also you make it so much harder for them. So, you know, you have like a light current and we have a heavy current, you have to be just as stronger. That's why I actually think female comics are a lot stronger in New York City, because you have to be. Right.
Generally, men's flow is less potent than a female flow. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
But
I
think we're all very hormonal and temperamental in this business regardless. But I do think in some ways, like I was talking about dyslexia.
Must not make joke. Must be mature. Go ahead.
But no, I think in a lot of ways, especially in New York City, at least I can say starting here and being here for 15 years, some of the female comics here I think are some of the best in the world, because
Completely.
It is that much harder.
It is. And it's, you have to want it as much. You have to put up with more shit. It's, I think, a rougher time. But
I also say this. I do believe the beginning is much harder. But once you get over the hump, once people start paying attention to you, I think it's a lot easier. Because then you have people, because there's so fewer people on the other side of it.
But doesn't it make good business sense to oppress female comics in that? No, I'm just, let me just pitch it. I own a comedy club, right? And men and women traditionally go out on dates to see comedy. Why would you put females on the show? Because it's a man and a woman going out on a date. The woman doesn't want to watch a woman.
Why doesn't she want to watch
a man? I'm being sarcastic.
Well, you know, statistically, women are the ones that organize going out nights for the most part. So you have a lot more women, whether, you know, the last thing I want is a bachelorette party, but you have a lot more women organizing stuff.
And women want to hear from other women.
But also, definitely, women are the ones
women
being like...
Women want to see female comics.
The stretch, and I thought where you were going with this was, does a man want to listen to a woman? But I think we're getting kind of past that point. And I think, you know...
I don't think you care whether or not we want to...
That's the other thing. Yeah. Really, we don't give a shit. So
we never have, really.
Right.
But what's also important is, like, I've heard about men having experiences my entire life. And I've paid attention because you're human and I want to know. And it's interesting. And if you have a punchline, I'll listen to whatever you have to say. So why is it not the same for me? If I have a strong punchline, why can't you go on a journey with me about what it feels like to be on a date on the other side of it? Mm-hmm. Or what it feels like to walk down the street as a
woman? I think men in New York will do that.
They do.
It's tougher in clubs, and it's very tough as soon as you leave New York. Yeah. If I go back, I started in Pittsburgh, where we had 3 female comics and 3 blind comics. What? So really, it was tough and tough.
3 yeah. blind comics.
3 blind, as many female comics as blind comics.
I hope they
Isn't
started
that wild?
A tour.
I mean, it's wild that there were 3 blind comics.
It would be great if the 3 blind comics booked the rooms.
I know. It was pretty cool. They just find a voice alone. Yeah. I know. That actually is really interesting. But I mean, just say there was 3 female comics. So they had a bit of an excuse. But when I go back there, it hits you in the face immediately. Like, oh yeah, I am not received the same way in middle America as in New York.
Yeah.
Well, they do not necessarily want to listen to
it. Older white heterosexual male comics will say, are you blaming the audience when it could be your fault?
But every comic can ask themselves that question.
My responsibility is to tweak, to adjust my level to their level. That is spot on. That's what you have to do as a comic, and you have to take responsibility. Any references that only make sense in New York, you obviously have to change, and it's the same kind of way. You have to meet them where they're at to a certain extent.
Right.
But you should not change what you were saying. You shouldn't change what you're doing. Well, they need to hear it,
Let me bring up this Jay Leno interview that was in the New York Times yesterday. He said that it's easier now to be a comic to get to the middle. Everybody can find their specific audience now.
Yeah.
What's really hard is to get to the top, because if you want to get to the top, you have to speak to everybody. And he kind of implied, and I think he was edited. David Itzkoff did the interview, and he's been on this show. I think David was protecting Leno. What's the matter?
No, against his will, I was joking.
What?
I said against his will.
Oh, against everybody's on the show against their will. Leno was getting into a little trouble. I think he was edited, but he was saying that if you want to get to the top, you have to be more inclusive, and that...
You have to be more watered down. I mean, the truth of the matter is I don't know if the top looks all that great, especially now with the top. Is not only do you have to be watered down where you say nothing because you can't offend anybody, but now if you do anything that offends anybody, they tweet attack you, and now you lose all your endorsements.
Well, it's very short-lived, for sure.
What is short-lived?
If you're at the top.
Yeah.
And what does it mean? So, in other words, what Leno is saying is to get to the top... You cannot only play to your crowd. Do you have a crowd?
Yeah, I think I have a crowd.
Who's your crowd?
I would say mainly females and open-minded males.
Okay.
I don't want to say like millennials, but I think I am liked by the millennial population. Definitely Brooklyn. I mean, that's a home run area for me. You know what I mean?
So maybe Leno and the gatekeepers at the top, if there are any left.
And
what?
I said, and gay men.
Well, that's millions and millions and millions of people.
Yeah.
It's millions and millions and millions of people.
Well, it's also,
it's a lot of people.
However, a lot of the stuff that I do might not work on mainstream television. A lot of people either might not get it, might be offended, all these things. So should I change that? Should I not include that in my act in order to get these opportunities? That's a decision that, every comic has to make.
Yeah, you have to decide, do I want to water down my voice that I've worked really hard to find in the first place to connect with everybody? And is that really connection? Or do I want to be fully myself and connect with the people that I wish I knew in high school? You know what I mean? When I felt very alone. So to me, I mean, I think a lot of my issue is that why would I want to say what you want to hear when I could say what I want to talk about and just find my people? I mean, that's why when you hear a song and it like blows your mind, you're just like, oh my God, like, I didn't even know that somebody knew what I was feeling.
And I think one of the best feelings doing stand-up is where a joke that you love does terribly, except for like three people, and they're dying.
Oh my God, that is, it literally is the best feeling.
This is so alien to me. It really is.
Because everything crushes for you.
Well, we bomb a lot.
Yeah, I mean, well, it's a generational thing, and
have more options.
It's the tail of the comet thing where you can find your audience. When I was starting out, I knew who my people were. And there weren't enough of them to please them. So you...
Or could you not get to them?
I couldn't. I still can't get to them. They're in prison.
But you have to understand, we have YouTube, we have Netflix, we have television. Yeah. We have not even just television. We have like 500 channels on television.
Okay.
We have apps. There's so many ways. There's Twitter. There's whatever. There's so many ways for you to find not only how you're going to say your jokes and put it out there, but how to connect to the people that are going to get it. The biggest issue is how do you monetize it so that you can make a career out of it.
All right, I'm going to push back just because it's interesting to push back. Isn't there some value to the friction between the comic and the audience? Isn't there something funny about a comic trying to make strangers laugh? If you show up to perform for your people, then you don't have to fight for their love. Is that funny?
I think it's still funny, but it's easier.
Yeah, and I do think that's why you can see sometimes known comedians start to be less sharp. Mm-hmm. I won't say they're not funny, but less sharp, because as soon as they walk into the building, people are just excited that they are who they are. People know what kind of perspective to kind of come about. But I think some of the great comics that continue to push boundaries continue to grow. Like I was telling somebody the other day that like, think about who you were when you were 10 and you were just trying to make friends, and somebody, you would show them something and be like, it's dumb.
Right.
And it would make you think, well, is this really dumb? Do I want to show people? And it kind of pushes you to move forward. Some of your closest friends, you show them something and they go, this is really good. This isn't good. You can do better here. And it pushes you forward. But then you get to a point where you're at some point valued that people don't want to tell you something is bad because they want to stay close to you for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. And same with an audience. And you don't get that feedback anymore. And you actually lose kind of touch with your dial of what's pushing the edge, what's funny, what's different, whatever. So I think in some ways there's some people that have a natural way of always pushing themselves and always staying creative and getting better. And then there's also people that once they have their audience and they can say whatever they want, they don't really want to push themselves
Explain
anymore.
To me the joy that comes from telling a joke that only three people get.
Because it's such a specific experience.
Are you putting me on? I can't help but wonder if both of you are being disingenuous. That
really?
That you're lying to me or to yourself.
Do you want me to give you an example?
This is so alien to me, the idea. I love this. The idea that you go up in front of 100 people and how many? Three laugh?
I'm not saying 100 people. I was thinking more of a bar show where there's maybe 40 people.
Yeah. Okay.
And no, that doesn't feel great when not everyone is laughing. But I think
But when it's the difference between people just not understanding you and these people understanding you so hard that the peer pressure of other people not understanding you doesn't even bother.
Is that right? I cannot fathom.
Do I want every joke to land that way?
Of course you do.
No, please no.
But you of course want everybody
but I'm saying,
to enjoy
that's a
yourself.
Fun, exactly. That's a fun little thing where I'm like, oh, they get it. And
you're
usually,
not terrified?
Not at that. Not if I have
suppose
the rest of a set
going.
That's doing
but
well.
Okay.
It's two different but, skills. Yeah, it's the difference between going into a party and being able to survive the party and walk away and people be like, oh, I really like that girl. She was really cool. And then somebody being like, I want to hang out with that person all the time. That person's awesome. So it's the same thing where like I can survive a room. I can make a whole room laugh. I know how to do that. But I really feel good when I connect with somebody.
Well, and what you said before, it's what kind of connection do you want? Do you want this mass connection where you are more mainstream, watered down, as you said, and it's resonating
offends,
with everyone?
Offends
or like
nobody,
a strong connection?
Says nothing.
Right, or a very strong connection with a few people who really understand and a deeper experience that you're conveying.
Because we can all sit here and be like, remember cell phones? How did we ever meet people? And make some kind of joke about the ability to like talk about the past and the future. Or I can tell you about something that's really happening mm-hmm. that really causes real emotion and is really weird that I know. Even if you haven't experienced it yourself, I can take you on a journey so you understand my experience. And if anything, I'm not looking for people that agree with me. I'm looking for people that are open enough to take a journey with me.
Right.
And some people don't want to take a journey with you. Some people want to hear the same pop song every year by different people, just with the, you know what I mean? It's just the same regurgitated shit all the time. And then there's some people that go, I've heard this song. Give me a new song. Give me a new thought. Take me somewhere else.
Right.
And truthfully, I'm not looking for people to want bullshit. I want people to be open to the adventure. And I think that's what you're looking for. There's a bunch of people that just want to eat the same shit at the same Applebee's
wow.
and never experience being uncomfortable. And then there's a bunch of people that are like, newness is uncomfortable, but it takes me somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really the difference, is a bunch of people that are willing to be uncomfortable.
And also love Applebee's.
Yeah, of course.
Isn't Applebee's supposed to be different in each town?
Isn't no, that I don't think so.
I think that's their...
Really?
I think that's their business model, where they...
What is different about an Applebee's that you...
I think the idea is that every Applebee's is different.
Well, even like McDonald's is different in Denmark than it is in America.
Oh, listen. If you want to talk McDonald's, I will talk McDonald's. Not that I love McDonald's food so much. I just love going to them and like
really?
The process of going inside. It's so weird. It's so weird. There was the Rock and Roll McDonald's in Chicago. Have you been to that? Wow. Incredible. There's an escalator. I actually went to the McDonald's at the Louvre in
There's
Paris.
A McDonald's at the... Oh, my.
I was like, I have to. Their sandwiches have béarnaise on them. So I was like, I have to try French McDonald's béarnaise sauce.
I love that
macarons.
You're like a garbage food connoisseur.
Yeah, I am. I love Taco Bell, too.
Really? I've never had it. I think I would die.
Oh, God. Liz!
I think
we met so many times, and I've not dragged you to a Taco Bell.
I have a very fragile body. I barely can eat real food,
well, yeah,
let
well,
alone
maybe you shouldn't, maybe
garbage.
You should go to Taco Bell. Yeah.
But I love that you're just like, it's a new McDonald's.
It is.
They're a lot nicer now. Every time I've peed in a McDonald's.
Well, you know what their model was? They wanted to become more like Starbucks.
You peed at a McDonald's, so you were one of the cooks?
Yeah.
I hate McDonald's. They're immoral.
It's disgusting.
They're destroying
yeah.
the planet.
It's bad. It's really
bad.
I don't want to encourage it, but...
Do you like the food? Do you like the taste?
Well, yes, of course. It's delicious. Yes. I don't want to eat it on a regular basis. You'll die. You saw the documentary. But... Yeah, it's really
what
good.
What do you eat there?
I get a crispy chicken snack wrap with honey mustard.
They're the
and
biggest...
And their ice cream is incredible.
The
chicken situation is very immoral. Very immoral. Like, they're raising chickens specifically
yeah,
for...
Yeah, with, like, no heads and stuff.
Yeah, it's really fucked up. Sorry.
Yeah, it
fuck.
Is.
Can you say fuck on this?
When you talk about McDonald's.
All right.
And they're, like, little pellets in their milkshakes, right? Filler.
I hadn't heard about that.
There's like some kind
Please
of...
Please don't ruin this for me, David.
Yeah. She has very little to live for. We're comics. Don't take this away from her. You do you, girl.
Thanks.
And they don't pay minimum wage. Or they do pay minimum
wage.
They do, but they don't pay a livable wage is what I meant.
But nobody pays a livable wage.
Right. No, it's not good. It's not good at all. That being said, if you were at the Louvre and you need a little break, you head to that McDonald's.
What do they call a quarter pounder in France?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Oh, you didn't see Pulp Fiction?
Oh.
Okay.
I have seen Pulp Fiction.
What?
Royale. Oh, yeah. Okay, I remember that. So bad with movie lines. I can never quote them.
Comedy audiences resist you in Pittsburgh, you say. The mainstream, generic comedy audiences. So do you book your own shows when you go to Pittsburgh?
Yeah, I mean, if I'm in the city and I'm in kind of like the hipper neighborhood or whatever, that's fine. When I go out to the suburbs, and also it's probably like, you know, sometimes my family's there and I'm like, oh, geez, okay, these people, you know, it's a little more intense. Parents either really like me because they're like, that's funny. I was like that at one point. Or they're like, wow, I hope my child does not meet this person. Stay away from my family. Yeah, that kind of thing.
What is Bitches Brew?
Bitches Brew is a comedy show. It's a all-female run, but we book men as well if they behave. And we do a musical act as well.
Musical Bitches comedy. Brew, so that you do stand-up?
Stand-up, yep.
And you'll have, oh, you don't do a group musical?
No, I mean, not yet. That sounds exciting, though. No, we do like a musical comedy act, you know.
Right, and you say if the men behave.
Right.
Were you being sarcastic or do they misbehave?
No, they're fine.
That's the best part about booking your own show. You book the people that you not only
we
respect
agree.
As comics.
And I don't know if I should put this information out there, but I don't really care. We discuss, there's four of us who run it, and we run by each other, each person that we're going to book. And if one person is like, no, he creeped me out or he did this to me, he was rude, he was, you know, whatever. And we're like, okay, cool, you're uncomfortable, he's not getting booked. So, and a lot of people say like, oh, is that, you know, winch hunt mentality or whatever? There's four of us, that's just our system, that's how it works. And I think we've gotten into that situation in the comedy scene in New York several times. So there's been people who have made so many poor decisions and offended so many people and made people so uncomfortable that they're not allowed at certain venues or whatever. And that gets trickier. But with our show, I mean, there's no question that that's the way to run
it. That seems to be, because of Facebook, I think men are finding out that women talk about men. There's a grapevine.
Well, yeah, because you have to protect yourself. Like
This has been going on forever.
Yeah, I mean,
but we're more easily connected now, even because there's Facebook groups.
Yeah, like I said,
it's very easy to communicate now.
It's easy.
Do you mind if we talk about this? Because I think it's a new phenomenon because of social media. Where
all it does is spread it out further. There's always been that connection. That's always been that, like, here's somebody.
Well, I don't want to speak in shorthand because I have a lot of listeners who don't understand what we're talking about, or maybe I just don't understand what we're talking about, but. I just heard that. Alex, it's a new phenomenon, okay? I know a lot of people don't know about this because men didn't know that women were talking about them as whether or not they were dangerous.
Yeah. Right.
This has been going on forever.
I think men don't talk about a lot of the stuff that women talk about. It's shocked me
so
sometimes.
So social media revealed a conversation that has been going on for millennia. Right?
Well, and so much is in writing now. You can show people texts. You can show people emails, Facebook,
so
whatever.
So when did this start? Did it start with Facebook?
What, the ability to connect it? Because you said, the conversation's always there. Yeah. I mean, Facebook groups kind of helped because it's one thing for me to be like, hey, I saw you're on a show with this guy, just so you know, he's a little handsy, whatever.
Well, and women, I think, owning their experience versus like...
Not being scared.
I hate to bring up, you know, the Cosby situation, but I think a lot of those women only handled that situation within themselves and maybe didn't either were embarrassed or scared or whatever and didn't reach out to people. And I don't know that for sure. But I think now women are getting to the point where like, oh, this is happening to a lot of us. And not only do I have a responsibility to myself to like process this and deal with it and move past it, but also to prevent it from happening to other women.
All right,
but
in general, hang on for 1 second, please.
I don't like being yelled at by a man.
Well, let me explain to you what that means. No. And Alex is going to push back here and say I'm boring, but I don't care. White people didn't know what it was like to be a black driver until the iPhone started having video capability. That's a fact.
Yeah.
If you're white and you heard black people say to you, you don't know what it's like to be arrested for driving while black.
I mean, we still don't.
We still don't, but in the past 5 years...
With all the videos.
With all the videos.
It's undeniable.
Technology has created an empathy because we are seeing it. It's more powerful.
Okay.
Yes.
I have been saying on this show that women are changing. There's something going on here.
Well,
and is it because, partly, obviously because men are dangerous, but is it, so you're saying that Facebook...
Well, you no longer think you're crazy. Like most people, the whole debate that like somebody gets raped or somebody gets molested and they go, well, why didn't you go to the police first? Why didn't you tell anybody? Because it's such a shocking experience that sometimes there's so much dialogue in your head that you don't always know how to digest it. Did I somehow cause this? Maybe when you're threatened about it, maybe he is going to harm me. There's like a gazillion questions that go on before you even tell your best friend or a therapist or whoever. So, and that goes with anything, but there's a lot of fear attached to it. So then when you have a community of people that say, hey, this happened to me. Oh, this happened to me. Oh, this has happened to me. All of a sudden, you're now, I do not know one woman that has never been molested, who has never been inappropriately touched, who has never been uncomfortable, because it's every, from as young as 7, it's happened to you. It's everyone's dialogue. But before, you were shamed into thinking that it was somehow you did something wrong or somehow you started this or something bad's going to happen to you if you tell somebody or you're going to be shamed.
Or if they weren't physically touched, they were emotionally abused.
Exactly.
Right.
So now when you realize it's been happening to everyone, you start to, the dialogue doesn't have to, you don't have to have all these apologies and all these, I don't know if this, you can just say that it happened and you can move forward. And then you can also be like, this is what I've done to feel safe. Like I carry around pepper spray and I carry around a safety cat, which is brass knuckles that look like a cat. They're illegal. I carry them. They've been taken away from me. I buy them for my friends. Like I, you know what I mean? I tell my sister first moved here when she was 18. I was like, she loves music. I was like, do not walk down the street with your headphones in. Do not, if you're on the phone, do not be distracted.
Okay.
So there's these things that you tell people, and that's just like a basis. This is New York City. This is da 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 da. But now with a community of a lot of men, and we're not the most emotionally capable people, women or men, a lot of shit goes down. We work late at night. A lot of people drink. And now people can say, not to say that everybody does it in the best light. And there are people that there's a lot of things that have been handled in our community that I don't completely respect. But at the end of the day, you can say, from my experience, this person has touched me inappropriately, has made me feel uncomfortable. Be aware.
As I understand it, throughout the course of American history, there are these great awakenings, spiritual awakenings, where people suddenly become, like the evangelicals are part of this great awakening, and Cotton Mather, and there is an awakening that's going on. You're nodding your head in agreement.
I am. Yeah.
And I've been saying this on this show, and people say you're a bore for doing it. You don't.
People say you're boring for believing in feminism?
Because I don't shut up about this because nobody believed me, especially guys.
What?
Yeah.
Really?
Well,
I think there's huge changes happening.
There's an awakening, and it started around 2012.
What specifically in 2012 happened?
Well, I think there's this confluence of Facebook becoming prevalent. People think Facebook has been around for a century.
Right.
It's only been around since 2008, 2007.
Yeah, right, yeah.
And then not everybody was on Facebook, but by 2012...
Well, I always say, yeah, like, I have the 5,000 friends on Facebook, but if you friend request me, I have 3,000 mutual friends with you, because it's like every single comedian I've ever met, mostly New York City. Like, so all of a sudden, my community, I could message just about anybody in my
right.
direct community.
The ability to organize now is, I think, what
and we see that
at.
With the Women's March. Women's March couldn't happen 20 years
and
ago.
And a group, not a group think, but a commonality. And I think in 2012, you had this election where women were reading news stories and they discover that Republican men actually think that when you're being raped, you can secrete a juice that prevents
you from getting pregnant.
You getting pregnant. Where Rush Limbaugh doesn't understand how birth control works. There was the fluke lady who testified. Yeah, and Rush Limbaugh pretty much said, I don't want to pay for your birth control. Every time you want to have sex, he actually thinks that you take the birth control pill right before having sex. I think there was this awakening.
There was this decision to not put up with that. I think the slut shaming, the word slut shame coming to fruition. And I have a joke, and that was actually the joke I was referring to when it's like the three people. Because I tell a joke that's now we have a word that allows you to like act the way that you want to act, which is so silly that like before there was this so much shame, so much whatever around things. And I would say you could have used that in 2004, right? And four women laughed because, yeah, like this has been going on and we've been doing what we want to do for so long, but there was a lot of
oppression. What do you mean slut shaming? Because Facebook started off to shame women. That's how Zuckerberg started Facebook.
You're right.
You
would be able to rate women. Able to say if you were single or not.
So what is slut shaming?
I mean, essentially what happened with Sandra Fluke. She was called a slut directly, wasn't she? That's slut shaming. Yeah, when you're saying a woman shouldn't have done something sexually. That is shaming her for
deciding
being a sexual
being. However you decide to go about your sexual life, if it's not in this narrow idea, because it still is this weird Catholic, like you don't have sex until you're married kind of thing. And anybody that's living a life outside of that is somehow a slut and shouldn't be able to explore their sexuality and shouldn't be able to talk about it. And however you live your life, I mean, men are able to say and do whatever they want, and everybody's like, it's just guys. And then women say it, and it's just like, ooh.
Well, right. I think
how is anybody ever going to marry you when you talk like
and
that?
And it was the time frame of being like, we don't have to put things that way. It doesn't have to be that way. We can act the way we want to act, and we can own our experiences and, you know, make decisions that we want to make, and it doesn't matter what an old white man is saying.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still fighting that, obviously, to the present day. With everything that's going on in healthcare,
what's going on in healthcare?
Oh, nothing really.
No, I'm saying like they want to cut Planned Parenthood.
Planned Parenthood.
Well, we've been told that shut up and make babies when somebody else decides you're going to make them.
Well, and then they're like, don't make babies, but also we're not going to give you rights to abortion, and we're not going to give you birth control, but don't have babies because we're going to have to pay them for them on Medicaid.
Yeah, and then we're not going to take care of them when you do have them.
Exactly. All of these decisions are being made so that women are between a rock and a hard place at all times. You can see that in our fashion. You can see that in all of these different constructs that have been set up to keep women down. It's really
upward mobility is trying to be stifled. That is really what's happening.
Or just any like almost quality of life kind of stuff. Sometimes,
yeah. But it's taking back what the birth control pill did for us and trying to eradicate it. Because if you learn anything about abortion before the birth control pill, abortion was how people, that was their form of birth control, and it wasn't seen as dangerous and it wasn't looked down upon.
Well, I don't understand how this is only just a women thing. Are guys not fucking as well? Is this not benefiting you?
Yeah,
like, it is a mutual thing. Like, you were creating life together, or choosing not to create life together. It's a whole
I think more and more men that we interact with are pro birth control and pro women's rights, but for the most part it's like, yeah, your life can be ruined too. Like, why would you not be on the side of letting us decide when and where we're going to have a child? To me it has everything to do with women's rights, and it has, yes, it's women's bodies, but it's what happens when you give women the control over their bodies.
But there's also women trying to take that away as well,
but that's
where it gets tricky.
Yeah, but I think a lot of that is I don't know, like fucking men fucking with women's minds. Like, to me, that's
well, it's religion.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it's religion as much anymore. I mean, I know I could sound ignorant there. I think religion does play some of it, but I think a lot of it has to do with brainwashing and letting people, like, same way that you can slut shame, I think you can life shame people, where it's just like, oh, you don't have any kids and you're 30.
It's a shame.
So that's the same idea that, like, everybody's trying to look like they have money, look like they have a house, look like they have the best kids. I mean, in a lot of ways, social media can be toxic in the sense that everybody's trying to look like they have their shit together. But everybody wants to look like they have this weird American dream from the 50s when the truth...
Which doesn't exist.
Which doesn't exist. And most people decided they weren't happy having it because you spend the rest of your life trying to pay for a house you never even wanted in the first place.
Right.
So here it's saying some of you can be 45 and be a freelancer and never have kids and live a life, and if you want to have seven kids, by all means have them, but they
they want everybody to be in that 50s box again.
But I think that's what feminism is you can make your choice and choose to live the way that you want to live, and we respect that. No matter what choice it is, not telling you what to do. And also holding women to a higher standard.
Yeah.
You know, like, sure, use your body if you want to use your body, but know that that is not all you have.
Exactly.
And that you have a responsibility to grow and to be intelligent and to,
but know. That's what, I mean, that's one of the things that I do like about the Netherlands. Like, prostitution is decriminalized. So this idea that if you're a prostitute in Amsterdam and somebody hurts you, you can call the police and you're protected.
Right.
You pay taxes on the money that make. You are not being cut, you know, you're not being murdered in a forest and not considered a person anymore because you sell your body. If that's your choice, you're protected as having a small business that is, and that's your life. And I don't see why we can't protect people, whatever their decisions are.
All right, so let me ask you about prostitution. How much? No.
No one should get a blowjob for less than filet mignon prices, and I stand by that wholeheartedly.
Well, I got a lot of questions I want to ask you. So prostitution, sex workers, do you believe there is such a thing as a sex worker?
Yes, I mean, there are. Of course. They're sex workers. They're right now, it's...
Why would you think there's not?
Yeah.
You seem like a man who has experienced some things.
Are they hiring? So do you envision a world where somebody can be a sex worker? Right? Hi, honey, I'm leaving. I'm going to go do my job.
Yeah, I know women that have boyfriends that was their job. They would go be sex workers. It'd be somebody's fantasy. They would do that. They're letting them, their partner knows that, and that's how they made money.
Okay.
And I think that's a beneficial thing. I think a lot of it's easy if you, you know, are like, oh, feminism, you don't want to, you know, you want everyone to be smart and whatever. No, it's about, again, making those choices and creating kind of like a safe atmosphere. If somebody wants to experience something, I'd rather them pay someone in the right way so it's a safe environment and they're not going out and, you know, committing sexual assault because they want to experience this. It's a person, two people consenting to something.
Right.
And if there's a monetary exchange, because this person is, that is their business.
And
then
I think
that
they
makes
should
sense.
Pay taxes.
They should. They should pay taxes. And there should be protection. There should be rates. There should be all of these things. So someone's not doing this involuntarily.
Yeah.
And
so would there be women who would do that and enjoy it?
There already are.
Yeah, there are.
And they
are.
Enjoy it.
Yes.
So let me just, dinosaur speaking here, maybe I believe this, maybe I don't. When you think of strippers, we're always told, well, their daddy F'd them over, right? That's not true.
No, I mean, there's always gonna be, and I mean, you could say that about just about every comedian. Yeah. Like, I mean, I don't think we're much different from strippers. Something went wrong in our childhood.
I agree.
Now we need attention by telling jokes.
I agree with you.
It's just a different form of.
I agree with you. I think we're exhibitionists.
So I, there's always gonna be people that fit the stereotype.
So you're.
But then there's people that like to dance. There's people that love being open about their body.
Right.
If somebody needs to do that as an outlet instead of heroin or whatever, then cool.
Why not?
I asked that.
And they make so much money doing it. From my friends that have stripped, I mean, they might do it. They might start doing it in a reason that's not for the best reasons. I would say the same thing about stand-up. It wasn't really the best reasons I got into it. But now I love the craft and it makes me happy. And I like connecting with people in that way. What's wrong with enjoying spinning around naked with booby tassels? I love burlesque dancing. I think it's like amazing. I've seen women that like were strippers in like a seedy place. And now they do it for like rock stars on huge stages as they tour the country. You have to have really good abs to do some of those spins.
Can I just be totally honest with you? I find this very confusing.
Really?
I do. I really do.
What's confusing about it?
Like pornography is, and I have seen porn. Women have said to me, these women are, there's something, women have said this to me, that there's something wrong with.
Some of them might.
Okay.
But then there's
a loaded situation with porn.
Don't say loaded.
And I would recommend. I just went to a talk on this. Rashida Jones made this whole series for Netflix. It's called Hot Girls Wanted, and it's about the amateur porn industry. And that, I think, is different than the standard porn. Adult women making choices, you know, it's an acting job. You have to remember it in that way. It is an acting job, and if that person is consenting to it and that's what they want to be doing, you can't not respect their desires and their wishes to do that.
What if you are on a porn set and the woman isn't ready yet? She has to take a pill and have a drink and has to be a little intoxicated in order for her to film her porn scene.
If that's what she's decided. That's a case-by-case
basis.
I mean, it's still...
If someone has to have a beer before they do stand-up.
I mean, that's also how many people say they haven't had sex sober, like in general, in a personal relationship. I mean, I think a lot of people do stuff for the wrong reasons, and it's their way of processing it. It's cathartic to them. It's them replaying their abuse, whether it's mm-hmm. verbal, physical, or whatever. I'm not saying it's right and that's the right way to process it, but if that's how they're processing
what is right?
it, what's wrong?
I know that sounds... You know,
I'm really just saying, yeah, I don't want to say right in
what
that
is
sense,
right?
And but it's also growth. Because my thing is, if you keep replaying over your abuse and you never get past it, then you're just replaying your abuse. And that's why a lot of people that were molested end up molesting people as they get older. Maybe that's okay. not the best thing to say. It has happened where people that have
if you went
been
to
abused,
a shrink,
abuse others.
If you went to a shrink and said, I'm a sex worker, what would the shrink say?
I mean, depends on the shrink, I think.
Well, there must be standard operating procedure when a woman or a man comes to a shrink and says, I make my money having sex.
Well, it would be basically asking if there's a problem with that, if they feel like they're doing it
okay.
for reasons that,
are
like if they're ashamed.
Because
that's the other thing is if you're doing something and you're ashamed of it, if I was ashamed of doing stand-up comedy the whole time, maybe this isn't something I should
I'm
be doing.
I'm very ashamed of doing stand-up comedy all the time.
All right, so I go to a shrink and say, I only have sex with prostitutes, or I only go to strip clubs and go into the VIP room.
Well, that sounds more like an addiction. If somebody says, I make my money doing sex work, if I was a therapist, I would first check to make sure that they're in a safe situation. Are they being controlled by
somebody else,
a pimp, or are they like receiving their money? How are they doing it? You know, now there's so much. I mean, on the regular internet, let alone the dark web, I mean, I think that's the problem with it not being
legal.
There's
a dark web?
There's a whole dark web.
There's a dark web.
Yeah.
Full of dark stuff.
Have you been on it?
I've not been on it.
No, my brother talks about it, though.
Does it really exist?
Yeah.
Is that where Bitcoin and everything?
Yeah, but that's also where a lot of selling women, like literally selling sex slaves.
And that is, I mean, now I will, this is so overwhelming to even think about. Just watched a thing. There was a woman who
I would never buy. I would never buy a woman on the dark web. Are they selling enriched plutonium?
Probably.
Because I want to stick my dick into that.
Totally.
That's how sick I am.
I don't know. I mean, that's when you get into a lot of like the underage stuff. And I feel like that's what really needs to be regulated. And it's not just the dark web. In the Village Voice, they were advertising. There's one woman who was taken or she ran away from home, was abducted at 15, was sold through an ad in a local New York paper. I believe it was the Village Voice. Sorry if it's
the back page.
Back
thing.
Page type stuff. Yeah. So that's clearly in our face illegal. Nobody's doing anything about that. There's loopholes where they can do that. And
is
that's
it funny?
What I think is really wrong.
Is it funny?
No.
I mean,
it is not.
Is prostitution funny?
I think you can make anything funny, but you have to be respectful of who's being harmed in it. I think that, I mean, I think you can joke about rape as long as you're being respectful of who is being harmed in it.
Are Bill Cosby jokes funny?
If they're done well. I think you can make anything funny. I would never tell anybody not to make a joke about something. I do think certain topics, you have a responsibility to be educated about it and understand.
You have to be respectful.
Yeah, I agree.
Of whom?
Of the people involved in it, because it's not your experience.
Right. Yeah. Right. We got to wrap it up. This has been very interesting. To say the least, with audiences being judgmental. I talked about this last week. There was a comic standing outside Dangerfields with me last week. He's Asian and African-American. I think he might have been gay. And he was complaining to me how judgmental and politically correct audiences are. And as a white heterosexual male, I kind of giggled because I thought, you're gay, you're black, you're Asian, and the PC police are coming for you. Is that happening? I just assume that only white men can be put on trial for being politically incorrect.
That's not true.
No, I mean, now that there's everybody, just like we said, Facebook, people can band together and make a group. Everybody can make a group. You can have a people that all are missing their left foot and they come together and they'll be like, what are my experiences?
Well, you have the Dyke March with the woman showing up with the Star of David. And you're,
yeah, and you're like, how do you marginalize within marginalized? You know what I mean? How would you ostracize somebody from a group that's already been ostracized? It's absolutely ridiculous.
But have you been yelled at by the PC police?
Everybody has. I don't think you can get away from it.
Okay, hang on. We have to wrap it up. But give me an example of the PC. Can a woman be accused?
If I said something hugely racist, of course.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Well, that's saying something that's sexist. And even if I were, can you say something sexist?
Sure. I could say something sexist against women and
feminist people. No, can you say it right now? I would help me.
So we can close out?
No, can you say something sexist and women call you on it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Is it happening a lot?
Yeah, I think that's another whole part of it where it's like, that's not feminist and blah, blah, blah. And I don't know if that's productive as well. Other women turning on each other for not being feminist enough or, you know, that kind of thing. But absolutely.
There's more checks and balances. And in some ways it's good. In some ways this is comedy and everybody
needs... Have you been called out?
Absolutely. I have a new joke. I'm growing a mustache. Like legitly, and I've tried everything to get rid of it, and I wrote it online, but I also do it in my act where I say, you know, I've tried everything to get rid of it, and somebody asked me, are you transitioning? And I said, not willingly. And a woman wrote to me and she was just like, this is not okay for you to joke like that. And I was like, I understand that this might be something that you read into and that you think is hurtful, but I have several transgender friends. Many of them are comedians, so maybe it's a different...
Why would that be offensive?
I don't see it as offensive either. It's me talking about my situation, which is that I'm growing a mustache. I'm a woman that does not want a mustache. And somebody asked me if I was transitioning. And I said, I'm not. That's not what I want to be doing. That's not the goal of it. If anything, I'm talking about...
But your body is turned against you.
Yeah, exactly. And
that's
funny. But I think a lot of trans women feel that way.
I can see people being pissed about that.
But I could also also see trans women also supporting it, where they're...
I could see that too.
Or trans men, people that feel
that
like they were put in a different body it's not functioning the way they want it to.
Right.
So if any way, it's like, why wouldn't this even be more relatable to you? Guess who it was? Non-trans person that was calling me out on it,
right?
Because all my trans friends laughed and enjoyed it. So it's usually people that are outside of it that start to be this PC police when it's just like, it's not even your experience.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand why.
That's always been the case.
Yeah.
I used to do a bit, we're going to wrap it up. I used to do a bit going after Vietnam vets. I used to talk about, why isn't there a memorial for the draft dodgers? You know, we were the ones who really ended the war in Vietnam by going to Canada. It's a bit, and there would be people who walked up, I know somebody who was in Vietnam. The Vietnam vets, the wounded ones, loved it.
Yeah, because they get it.
Protect yourself. Well, Liz Miele, how do people reach you?
My website is lizmiele.com, M-I-E-L-E, and everything is at Liz Miele on all the social media.
Melissa Stokoski.
Yeah. I'm at M_STOKS, super easy, and Bitches Brew, which we talked about, is every Friday at 8:30 at Halyards in Gowanus in Brooklyn, so you can find that on Facebook.
And I'd like both of you to spell your last names.
Sure.
Miele.
That is correct.
Thank you.
Mine's tricky. Let's see if I can get it. STOKOSKI.
Thank you. You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.